Hello and welcome to This Is Difficult Gaming Podcast, episode 62. Really? I forgot to turn on music, but that's okay. This is the show where we talk about video games and other things, but mostly just video games. I am your host, Paul, and I'm here with my co-hosts, Colin and Josh, aka Zach, today. Because Josh couldn't join us. Unfortunately, he got sucked into work.
You should have put Josh's face in the milk thing.
You know,
I can't. Actually, I still have Josh. Here we go. Boom. Josh's face is on the milk thing.
Nice. For the longest time, my wife's grandmother thought my name was Josh.
Oh.
For like 2 years.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God.
Like Usually I replace
his name with, hold on, I could probably still do it. Yeah, here we go. Nope, just kidding. That's what I have for that. Never mind. We're not going to change it. You're Josh today.
Sounds good.
There we go. Well, we talk about video games and other things on this podcast. Let's talk about some games that we played this week, guys. Did you play any games this week? We're going to wait on you, Zach, because you've got kind of a bigger game that we want to talk about.
I'm really excited to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah. Me too.
Good and bad.
Yeah. Good and bad. Colin, did you play any awesome games this week?
No. I didn't play any good games this week. Let me see. Nothing? Recent games, I played Dead by Daylight. That's it. Yeah. I have not been playing games at all lately.
That is a bummer. This
I know.
Video
I've been
podcast.
Editing a lot, though. I've been doing a lot of fun editing, though. Like, really
That's
cool
good.
Stuff.
That's cool. I'm really excited about the stuff that you're doing. So.
Yeah.
I also got to play video editor this week, and I'm so happy to be back to it. Just feels good.
I didn't know you video edited.
I have a film degree.
I had no idea.
Yep. My undergrad work was in film.
All right, pick your brain then for some things.
For sure. Yeah, absolutely. Anytime.
That'd be awesome.
That is very cool. So I played our featured game this week, which I'm going to wait to talk about in detail until you guys have a chance to play it. But that's Dead Cells.
Yeah, we have 2 weeks, right? Like another week after this.
Yeah, I think that's fair, because Dead Cells is a game you can get the feel of it in just one play. But I mean, if you really want to dig into it, it's fair to give it 2 weeks. Plus, you guys haven't touched it yet. So awesome freaking game. That's all I'm going to say. And it's so much fun. And you can play it with a Twitch mode if you're streaming. So I would highly recommend playing it on stream, because it just brings a whole new level to the game. Like, it's just extremely entertaining. Yeah, so I played that, and I've also been playing just like in my off time, because I haven't really had a chance to like sit down and play like console games or on my PC. But I've been playing on my 3DS a little bit, like while I'm working, and I finished Zelda Minish Cap last week, and then I restarted Ocarina of Time 3D.
I love that game.
I love it. It's so good. And the remaster on the 3DS is phenomenal.
You like the controls?
The controls are so much better. It's so nice to be able to use the motion controls for the slingshot controls and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Feels good.
Oh, it feels so good. The graphics look so much better. Like, oh my God. I can't wait to start Skyward Sword.
That was like a
I
port,
know.
Basically. That game was a port. Yeah. And so a lot of the problems with it carry over. Mm-hmm. Like, they didn't actually rework a lot of the code. They just like kind of kept it in there. And
yeah, they
shows.
Just kind of gave new polish to it and adjusted some of the controls.
Yeah.
But the game still holds up. Like, it's a fucking incredible game. So what's the first time you go to Mount Doom as a kid, the Dodongo Cave or whatever?
Yeah.
Dodongo's Cavern.
Yep. Mm-hmm. I just finished that.
Nice.
So that was a lot of fun.
I heard something really cool about that game. So you can refight bosses, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the way you do that is in his home, in his bed. And someone's like, that's basically him having PTSD, you know? Like,
oh,
you're
my
going
God.
Back home, and he's having PTSD, and he's reliving his nightmares.
I never.
Oh, my God. That's dark.
Isn't that crazy?
That's
yeah,
nuts.
That is wild.
Yeah.
I never even thought about that. That's so crazy. All right. So that's what I've been playing. I didn't really even touch Destiny this week except for yesterday, because I've just been so busy. Mm-hmm. Perfect. Adam's here. This is a great time to talk about the game that just released from Adam's company based on his characters and his games. Josh here. AKA Zach, got a chance to play it this week, and we want to hear his thoughts.
I spent almost all day yesterday and most of the day today playing the new video game Sentinels of Freedom. For a Sentinels fan, especially someone who's really into the story, like myself, I do a story stream with Sentinels, the card game, every week, and I have for the last almost 4 years.
4 years?
Yeah, yeah, it's been a long time. I've been doing the Handelabra thing for a long time.
I did not know that. It's cool.
And from a story perspective, it's so much fun and so compelling, but you really have to know what's like the characters already. And if you don't, I don't know that it holds up. It's
pretty... To me, the gameplay looks really compelling. The graphics, I think, maybe could use a touch up, but like I really enjoy like tactics style gameplay.
I thought I did.
Oh man.
Maybe it's just I've been out of the tactics thing for a while. I haven't played XCOM, at least not in a very long time. I never really did the like portable, like the handheld tactics games, Fire Emblem, anything like that. I've watched people play them, and I can sort of think my way through them, but actually sitting down and doing it proved incredibly frustrating. Because what I was noticing is the game sort of gives you a giant info dump at the very beginning. Mm-hmm. And it's like, here's how to move. Here's how to take a basic action. Okay, great. Now here's like 10 pages of stuff consolidated into these random panels around the screen that you now need to memorize.
Oof.
It's like a game manual appears on your screen.
It's like Monster Hunter.
Sure. And me, especially being on stream, I was like, yeah, too long, didn't read, don't care. Move on. Teach me the game. And it didn't. It just dumps you into this knockdown, drag-out fight with two established characters, two established villains from Sentinel Comics. I was completely in over my head. Wow. And by the end of that fight, I was legitimately angry. I was like, dang, why don't I get like the, you know, Heritage, the sort of figurehead character, walking me through like, this is, you know, this stat is, you know, or this particular ability is strong against this particular type of enemy, or, you know, they give it to you in these weird charts and graphs that almost make it look like Homework the video game.
Dang.
And I had to text my buddy, my podcast partner this morning. I was like, Doug, you're not going to enjoy this game. It's there's too much homework at the beginning. Like, once I got used to it, it was about, I mean, I streamed for a long time yesterday, something like almost 5 hours. And only about halfway through, about the time, Colin, that you guys showed up, you and Faye showed up, that's when I was starting to find my legs. And it was my second go through on the bank vault. Total party wipe, my first go through. Like, that doesn't feel good.
Is there difficulty settings?
There is. And I'm playing on standard. There's four difficulty settings. There's easy, standard, hard, and insane. I was like, I could, you know, my level of adeptness or whatever at video games in general, usually I'll go to like hard, as I do with Gears of War. But I was like, I don't know this game at all. I'm dropping it down to standard. And that criticism was kind of unilateral. I know Chamali was saying he experienced in a similar way. There were a couple of other chat people who were like, yeah, it's really, it dumps you in.
Once you do have the hang of it, how do you feel about it?
So I've been playing it a lot more now, and I still find that like the enemy units, especially there's like it almost feels like Warhammer 40K in terms of unit cohesion. Like you'd think that, okay, this block of five guys is going to move generally together. They don't. They spread out all over the place.
Yeah, that's pretty standard for like old school tactics games. Like I mentioned, Shining Force, Final Fantasy Tactics, Ogre Battle, things like that.
Right.
They're not a block of units, they're individual units.
Right. And when they're labeled in the overlay, in like the action order as a block, I expect them to have some behavior as a block, even if they are fanned out a little bit.
Oh, okay.
Where there's other units that are just a single dude, and I expect them to be doing whatever the heck they want.
Interesting.
So it's very difficult to track people down. And especially like you'll get one guy who's just randomly hiding around a corner while the rest of his unit pelts you with fire or with gunfire. And it's like, why, what are you doing over there? You're clearly following some kind of order. What is that order?
Commando.
Yeah, I guess. And he's not even, he's just a mook. So I was like, there is definitely, a huge steep learning curve to it.
So Adam said there's also a learning engine in it, so they're reevaluating tactics based on what abilities you can learn lean on.
Okay, see that
very interesting.
Once again, that's something that I did not see communicated, and again, it may be because I'm rushing through it or rushing through those the game manual effectively.
The learning, what does that mean exactly? I'm not sure what that means.
So that's something
that's machine learning. So like they're adapting their tactics to
your play style.
Yeah. So it's like an AI basically.
Yeah.
The enemies are.
So that's something that I struggle with games. Like I said, I mentioned before Monster Hunter. Like especially if you play it on stream, it's different when you're playing it off stream, right? Mm-hmm. Off stream, you're going to sit down and you're going to, you know, read tutorials and things like that. 99.999% of the time, if I'm playing a game off stream on stream, or even if I'm playing it like kind of like I just want to get a gaming fix and want to play something quick, I'll skip over all that stuff. And that always shoots me in the foot with Monster Hunter. If I don't have someone that is there to Sherpa my ass through something, I'm trash. Now that's something that Nintendo, on the other hand, does amazingly well with their video games, is instead of like sitting there and giving you pages and pages of text to like teach you how to play the game teaches you how to play the game.
Right. Right. And like, I know that irritates a lot of, you know, hardcore or competitive players. That's not me.
Sure.
You know, and especially, and I don't think it's most of the Sentinels community. Like they're looking for, they're looking for a Sentinel story. And you know, I was visiting Greater Than Games about a year ago, and I mentioned to someone that the people who are concerned about the story are concerned about the story coming out of Adam and Christopher's office.
Right.
And they don't really care how that's presented as long as it's accessible.
Sure. Sure.
So when we're dropped into this scenario where there's, you know, a literal chart, like a graph of weapon and combat equivalencies, it's really, really intimidating until you realize, oh, that's what that means.
Yeah. So then once you do, I kind of asked you this question a little bit ago, but like once you feel like you have a proficiency, how does the gameplay feel? Like, do you feel like it does a good job compared to other tactics style games or?
Yeah, it does. I was stuck on a level today that it really, like, my tactics were wrong when I did it the first two times, and then when I reevaluated, I'm like, oh, wait a minute, I need the team that I'm bringing to this is not correct. And that I reevaluated my strategy. I was much more successful, which is exactly what you would expect out of a tactics game.
Sure.
You reevaluate strategy, you bring a different team, and generally you are more successful once you know what to expect. I think there's still bits that I don't expect.
Yeah.
Or that are behaving differently than I expect. And that's frustrating. And Chamali points out that the chart that they give you for the, you know, attack equivalencies and defense equivalencies doesn't use basic terminology. It's almost entirely symbols. And that's incredibly frustrating and confusing.
Okay.
But again, once you get used to it, it's much more playable.
So for someone that is like a hardcore tactics game enthusiast, would you recommend it?
Hardcore? No, probably not. There's probably better games. But for a Sentinels fan, the story is really fun.
Yeah.
And it's like, it feels like a comic book, which is like the highest praise you can give a comic book game. Is like, and I'm not just talking about the fact that like the cinematics are comic pages that I could take or leave. It feels like, you know, the tone of a comic book. which is really
very
cool.
Good.
It is a good Sentinels game, if not necessarily a great tactics game.
Right on, man. Well, I'm still pretty interested in checking it out. I do really enjoy tactics games. To me, it looks like a lot of fun.
I am having fun with it now. Like, I'm definitely having fun with it now.
Right on. Yeah. But that's really interesting to hear. And probably decent feedback, constructive criticism and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
But right on. Did you play anything else this week?
I mean, in between Zoom meetings, I'm playing Mega Man Zero, or I guess ZX at this point. But no, other than that, it's pretty much it.
Cool. You guys want to get into some news?
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Right on. We got some interesting stuff this week. So a new update for the Nintendo Switch just came out. And in the firmware were hidden some really interesting things about new Nintendo models. Okay, so there's two new Nintendo Switch models aside from the three existing ones currently, right? So you've got your original Nintendo Switch, you've got the Switch Lite, and the slight revision of the Nintendo Switch that has like the better screen and the better battery life, right?
That was like softly launched. Like,
yeah, it was soft launched. The only difference that you would know looking at them in the store is one's got a red box, like an all red box, and that's the newer one, right? But there's two more, okay, listed in the firmware, which is really quite interesting. One of them has a dual screen. So one of them has an additional screen. I don't know if it's built
like
in
Wii,
or if it's...
Think?
I don't know if it's like the Wii U or or the Nintendo DS, or if it's like... Someone that I follow was suggesting it might be like a VR model of the Switch.
Wow.
And so it plugs into like a VR set that you could wear.
Well, Nintendo does have the Labo VR thing.
They do, yeah. And that wasn't very successful, but...
Yeah. Don't talk about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
But, you know, who knows? So I just think it's really interesting. The interesting thing is that of the two models they listed, one is still using the old Tegra X1 chip that the original Switch uses, mm-hmm. Which we know that NVIDIA is working on a new chipset, probably the one that's in the new Shield model for the Switch Pro. The other model does not have a chipset listed. So, and actually I think that's the dual screen model that doesn't have the chipset listed. So potentially that could be the Switch Pro. We don't, you know, at this point it's definitely just speculation, but I think it's really interesting that there's a second display listed in there. Another really cool thing that was added to the Switch firmware, which I don't think they really tell you, you can now remap all the buttons on your Switch.
Oh.
All of
them. Oh my God.
On any controller.
So
you can do it on your Pro controller. You can do it on your Joy-Cons. You can do it on whatever you've got set up.
Like that's a thing that's currently
It's just
happens.
A standard thing that you can do on your Nintendo Switch right now if you're
Why
on the latest
firmware.
Why is
that standard across all fucking consoles? That's incredible.
I don't know,
yeah,
but it's amazing. No. And you can even remap the L3 and R3, like the clickable stick buttons. You can remap those to something else.
You think that's what they're preparing for, like the new Mario games to come out, like for that reason?
I think so. Yes, because we talked about how there's not a analog trigger on any Switch controller, right?
Yeah.
And so, in order to be able to play, which Mario is it? Mario Sunshine, using the water pressure and whatnot, like you need that variance. So in order to have that, you might have to like remap a button to like one of the sticks or something like that, you know? So I really do think that might have something to do with it. But yeah, that's really cool. I think, yeah, that should be standard across all consoles, right? For accessibility purposes. But yeah, that's something that's really cool that was just added in the recent firmware.
Mm.
Another thing that was added was the ability to move games across your memory within the Switch. So if you've got a game saved on internal memory, you can move it to your SD card now, which is really cool.
That's
so,
cool.
That's yeah, yeah. It, the weird thing, though, is you can't move your saves.
Oh.
So if you want something to be stored on your external memory, you better hope that it's one of the few games that allows for cloud save. You just don't care about your saves. But I think that's something they should have, you know, done a long time ago. But it's interesting. I think it's something cool. And I don't know, like, because I've never noticed anything new when they do an update. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Like, I always find this stuff out from people who do, like, the data mining and whatnot. I think that those features are definitely things that they should be, like, announcing. Like, hey, you can do this now. Hey, you can remap your buttons.
Right. That is some kind of strange. Not like, hey, you know, Nintendo users, check this out. Like, where do I go to see this stuff, you know?
Well, I don't know. Uncharted
Have they not announced that at all? Like, the only reason we know that is because they've just...
I haven't turned on my Switch since because I just haven't had time.
I'm just kind of...
I don't know if someone can confirm that. Yeah.
I didn't look.
Oh, there's an update.
There you go. Do the update and let's see if it tells you.
I did an update yesterday and I didn't.
I was playing Mario Maker.
I wasn't looking at it. Yeah.
I usually don't. Do they give you like, hey, here's the new...
I doubt it. I've gotten a few different updates and they never like say anything. It's just like, okay, it's updated. Thanks.
Right, exactly. That's generally my experience with updates. There's like, where's the patch notes?
There's a lot of in the eShop. No, there's nothing.
There's featured news, maybe. No, just like what's on sale, what's happening. Nothing too crazy.
Yeah. Weird.
Where's that button remapping thing though? I was kind of curious about that.
It should be in your controller settings.
Controls.
Oh yeah.
Change button mapping.
Change button
mapping. Hey, there you go. Pretty cool. I'm gonna have to play with that. Because there's some games like Zelda where I feel like the controls are upside down.
Dude,
like the buttons are upside down. Yeah.
There's like this weird like X thing up here. You're like, hang on. Oop.
Yeah, why is it there? Needs to be on the other side.
Even Zero, like the dash and secondary attack button uses the bumper. Like, why not use the big trigger?
I always use the bumpers to dash in every Mega Man game.
I don't know.
That's just always what
this
I was
could be
used
also
to.
Huge for like Super Smash Brothers and like tournaments. You know, people come up and they go, "Oh, I want my button mapping set up."
Oh yeah, for sure, for sure. Yeah, Breath of the Wild would be 100% better. I concur. Yeah. Anyway, that's very cool stuff. Uncharted Collection and Journey are going to be given away for free as part of PlayStation's Stay at Home initiative. So if you're an Uncharted fan and you don't have that on your PS4, Uncharted Collection is free currently. And Journey as well, I hear, is a freaking amazing game. I've never played it, but I've heard that it's like playing a painting. Like, it's like playing an art piece.
I didn't like it, but to each their own, you know? Like, if you liked it, that's fine. I didn't understand the big hype behind it. I thought it was a cool game, but like, I just couldn't get into it, man. I don't know. I tried to like it. So.
I mean, not everything's for everyone, right?
Yeah, that's what I felt like. It was like, I guess this game's just not for me. I mean, it was really pretty and minimalistic. I like the style. And I feel like that's the kind of game I would make. But like, I don't know. I just didn't like it. I was just like, I couldn't get behind it. And like, people that loved it, like, really loved it, you know? So. Mm-hmm.
No, I'm excited about the Uncharted Collection, though. That's pretty. Someone told me that when I was streaming Gears the other day, and
to answer chat, I'm not 100% sure if it's for free or for PS Plus. I think they said it was 100% free.
That's what I got too.
But they might throw in that catch that you need PS Plus. But there's already other games free on PS Plus this month. Let me see what those are real quick. If I could type. Free games 2020 lineup. Uncharted 4 actually is free right now, and Dirt Rally 2.0 are free on PS Plus right now. And so that's this thing is external from PS Plus. So I think it's just free. Oh my goodness. Lord Yeshua is hosting us.
Hey.
There he is. What a guy. What a guy. We'll be definitely raiding Yesh after this. Question, where did the most attractive host go? On the
right. Here, buddy. Right here.
He's here. So I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah. We're not going to say which one it is. But
on time.
Yeah. Yeah, I was the only one on time, so go fuck yourself.
Hey, now.
And okay. Zach was on time.
Nice.
Zach was on time. yes, but yeah, so I think to answer your question, it sounds like it's free. I would go check that out. If you don't have those games and you're interested, those are some very awesome games on the PlayStation. Here's what I'm excited about. I was looking forward to talking to Yesh about this because I think he's the only one that's as excited about this game as I am. But early reports say that Ghost of Tsushima gameplay is going to be like a mix between Way of the Samurai and Tenchu, which makes me hard as a rock.
Like, gross.
Those are two of my favorite games of all times. Like, I'm so excited about that. God, I can't tell you how excited I am to play that game.
When's it come out, you said?
I believe it's still slated for June.
That's really soon. That's like
That is really soon.
It's going to be here.
That is really soon.
It's
going
to come out
so,
now, though. You know, I'm always sad.
Yeah. So basically...
Terraria update's coming out next month. That's pretty cool. last Terraria update.
Is it the last one?
Yeah, it's Journey's End. It's the very last update.
Oh my god!
So I'll be playing through that again pretty soon, and then
we still need to have a Starbound day. We need to.
Oh yeah.
We need to crack open the old Starbound. I love it. I absolutely love it. But yeah, so apparently you'll have the choice to play more stealthy, like Tenchu. You know, you can go like the ninja route, the ghost route, if you will, or you could play more upfront, like a samurai, and it plays a lot more like the Way of the Samurai games. Which is just freaking awesome. I'm so excited. I can't wait. I really hope this game opens the avenue for more samurai games on the Western side, because there's so many games that never came here that are amazing. You know? You can only get them if you import them, and it's just... I'm excited. Yeah. I'm very excited about it. But yeah. Anyone remember Crysis?
Terraria
equals ukulele.
So Crysis is a game that it's almost like they intentionally made the game not to run on any computers for 10 years down the road.
Yep.
Right?
That's what I hear. It was always like the litmus test for a good
computer. Yeah, it was. It was like, can your computer run Crysis? Or like, what frame rate does your computer run Crysis at? Yeah, it was a meme for a long time. Early on, the game was way ahead of its time. Well, it's getting a remaster, and it's coming to all consoles, including the Nintendo Switch.
Thereby implying that these consoles can handle the remaster.
Right. Yeah. Can your Nintendo Switch handle the remaster? yeah, I mean, I think it's an old enough game that it should be able to handle it. But, you know, we'll see. We'll see.
That's super cool.
I mean, do see...
When Crysis first came out, I did not have a computer that I barely had a computer that could handle an emulator. But I never played it. I would watch friends play it, maybe. It badly.
I've never played it either, because back in the day, my computer was nowhere close to being able to handle Crysis.
Right. Right.
I remember getting my first 128-bit graphics card.
Yep.
Yeah.
My little Mac Mini still couldn't handle it.
Yeah.
That's what's in front of me right now.
Mini, really?
I love my Mac Mini. It's a new one, but
oh my god, yeah. Dude! I had to like keep like throwing RAM in my poor little Mac. I was like, "Come on, you can do that. You can render this." a little more RAM for you.
I'm on my PC right now, but that's like they're both there.
Dude, I mean, I used to love my Mac. I still have it, but like,
yeah.
I mean, nothing compared to my computer now. You know,
I adore my Mac. I don't know where I'd be without it.
Yeah, dude, I rendered so many videos on my Mac Mini, but. Yeah, that's funny.
My roommate spilled a milkshake on his Mac.
Oh, did it recover or was it just broken for that?
It kind of runs right now. I think, and his plan is to crack it open and get in there with some isopropyl alcohol and stuff and give it a good cleaning. But it kind of runs. It kind of does its own thing. But yeah. Yeah. It's pretty wild. Yeah. No, so
that'll,
anyway.
That'll be really cool. That'll be
Crysis
nice.
Will be interesting. And actually, I'm actually excited to play it. Like, yeah,
for sure.
I've never played it because, like you said, didn't have a computer that could run it. And, like, by the time that I could afford a computer that could run it, I had kind of, like, removed myself from PC gaming for, like, mm-hmm. several years,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's just not something I ever got a chance. But that begs the question, though, is are they going to maybe make a sequel or, like, a new Crysis game? I know that... Are you
Wasn't there a Crysis
2?
I thought there was a Crysis 2.
I think there is Crysis 2. But... it would be really cool to see what they can do on the CryEngine with like the new ray tracing technology and things like
right.
that.
Right.
You know, that's pretty interesting. So yeah, we'll see what happens with that. You gotta think that if they're putting out a remaster, they're trying to, you know, drum up some hype for something, right? Like otherwise why else do that?
Yeah.
So
the only ones that I could think of that would, just do it to do it would be Square Enix because mm-hmm. the fans have been clamoring for Final Fantasy VII Remake for years.
Oh yeah. Yeah, definitely. Speaking of JRPGs that you know, people are pretty stoked about, Phantasy Star Online 2 is confirmed to be coming to PC as a timed Windows Store exclusive in May. Which is weird. It's already come over on console, I believe,
yeah.
And people are enjoying that. I know I've got a friend that, like, all he ever talks about is Phantasy Star Online.
I loved that game growing up. Phantasy Star
yeah.
Online?
Yeah.
Is it episode 1 and 2? Is that?
Well, this is Phantasy Star Online 2.
Is that different
so,
between... The one I played was the Phantasy Star Online episode 1 and 2.
Well, this is, like, the MMO. It's yeah, so it's not like a... I think the original Phantasy Star Online, yeah, I mean, that's a real throwback. Like, the original Phantasy Star Online, I think, was on the Dreamcast, right?
Yeah.
Dreamcast
and maybe...
GameCube,
yeah.
Yeah. But, yeah, so this is just straight-up Phantasy Star Online 2, which is the MMO that's been out in Japan for years, I'm pretty sure. In fact, I know people who have played on... like translated servers and things like that, like you know, I guess technically pirated, but that was the only way to get the game in the West. Mm-hmm. So people have been doing that for years, but yeah, it's finally officially coming in May to the PC, and that is a timed exclusive, so I would assume that once it leaves the Windows Store, it's going to be on, you know, every platform, I would guess.
Yeah. So. Me either, Adam. He says, I don't understand the use of internet or network functions on the GameCube. Doesn't make any sense.
Wasn't there a modem that you had to plug into the
there
fucking
sure
bottom
was.
Of it?
There sure was. Yep.
Yeah.
It
was
like a gray, like, tablet thing.
Yeah. Yeah, that thing was weird. I don't think I ever used GameCube online.
No.
In fact, I think my first online experience with a video game was Battlefront 2 on the... Or no, Battlefront 1 on the PlayStation 2.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was my first ever online gaming experience on a console.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, Lord Yeshua, there was a Phantasy Star for SNES.
Yeah, there's a Phantasy Star for NES, I'm pretty sure. The original Phantasy Star, I think.
Those games were fucking awesome. That's insane. Mm-hmm. That's a throwback.
Yeah,
I that for hours. I played that offline though. I played the offline version, so it was like Phantasy Star,
right.
Episode 1 and 2.
Yeah,
right.
My buddies.
I think it was
it.
Still called Phantasy Star Online.
I think, yeah. And they got. I think what soured me it on it was, I didn't have a console. I would play at their houses.
Yeah.
And they would get really frustrated with me because I couldn't keep up. The only time I could play was
sure.
with them.
Right.
And I was like, okay, it's just not for me. No big deal. And I moved on.
Right, right. Yeah. Yeah, I had experiences. I think we all had experiences like that as children. In fact, like, we weren't allowed video game consoles in my house until the N64 came out. Like, well, we had an Atari.
Oh.
We had an Atari that was my dad's, and that was the only video game console we had for years. And then right before we moved from Colorado to where we're at now, or where I'm at now, my parents got us Game Boys. And I think that was just to keep our mouth shut during the freaking road trip, you know?
super effective.
Yeah. Well, my brother got his for his birthday the year before, and then I got mine for my birthday, but I wasn't even allowed to play it until the road trip, which was fucking bogus. But yeah, anyway. And so then once we moved here, like, yeah, we weren't allowed any consoles at all. We had the PC. And so how Adam and I played like classic games growing up was either at friends' houses or on emulators.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally, my grandma was going to get us a N64, and my parents told her not to. And then our like close family friends ended up getting us an N64 for that Christmas, and it fucking pissed my grandma off so much. It was really bad because she was visiting from California.
Oh, no.
Yeah. And so she was furious, but we were stoked. We were playing Mario 64, having like the best time ever. And then, you know, after that, we had, you know, like we really dug into video games after that. Adam, you know, got his first job and like would buy every console that came out and all that stuff. So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was good. Good old times. But I don't know why I went off on this tangent. we were talking about...
playing games at friends' houses.
Yeah, we're talking about playing games at friends' houses. Yeah, so I grew up like that for, you know, the majority of my childhood, like until the 64 came out, you know. Yeah. It was like that was my experience.
Once my parents trusted me enough to ride my bike to my friends' houses, it stopped being an issue.
Right. Yeah, like we within the cul-de-sac that we lived in, most of our friends had, like, we had our one friend that had the Sega Genesis and our other friend that had the Super Nintendo and yep. Friend down the street had the Sega CD and yeah, like it depended which flavor of video games we wanted to play that day. That's what friend we were hanging out
cool,
with.
So.
Yeah,
it was good. And then our final bit of news, this one's obscure. So, you might have noticed, you might not have, but it's really, really, really hard to get your hands on a Nintendo Switch these days.
I've heard that.
Because of, like, the quarantine and everything, everyone wants to play games. Like... picking up, yeah. Right. Yeah, I've got mine, which I'm super happy about. I would have loved to upgrade to the better battery life version, but, you know, it's whatever. But apparently, what people are doing to get around that is building their own Nintendo Switch.
What?
Apparently... I'll tell you.
Yeah, please do.
So, apparently there is methods of buying all the components. I think it's like 21 separate components you need to buy separately. And you can buy them for like repairs and stuff, right? But you buy all the separate components and put it together yourself. What? And there's people that are actively doing this right now.
Kit bash Nintendo Switch.
How crazy is that?
That's insane.
Yeah,
like, that's so risky.
It is. Because what if you get a bad panel, or what if you get a bad, you know, motherboard or whatever, you know?
I mean, you can't send it back at that point. You just have
right,
because
most
over.
Of these components you're buying off of like eBay and stuff. But there's actually a list of components. Actually, let me see if I can find it real quick, and I'll post it in the chat if I can find it. Give me just a second. Talk amongst yourselves.
I would be absolutely horrified to try and do that. Like, I can build a PC with my eyes closed, because the parts are largely interchangeable and they only go in one possible place.
Things?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you do.
I can solder.
Unfortunately, that is a thing I can do. I mean, I repair my guitar all the time, but like,
you have to solder your guitar?
It's an electric guitar.
Oh, it's like the electronic component to the solder.
Yeah. The potentiometers and stuff.
I would never, ever thought to do that. That's kind of crazy. That's cool.
My current guitar has been ripped apart and put back together probably 4, 5, or 6 times, depending on
that kind of stuff. I had to fix my bulb today. It like blew out because it was, I don't know what happened, but I had to resolder something and it's fixed now. So
nice.
Yeah, it was fun.
I'm building a new guitar actually slowly. It was at one point the guitar that we all left in the practice room at the high school because we were too poor to actually buy our own guitars. And we all took our private lessons on the same guitar. And cool. My buddy was getting rid of it and he was like, oh, make something awesome out of this. So I'm completely gutting it and rebuilding it.
That's awesome.
Really fun. Yeah.
There you go. In chat, the Reddit post on how to build your own Nintendo Switch. And I'm pretty sure it lists all the components. I think that it costs almost just as much as a brand new Nintendo Switch, maybe a little bit less. And that's if you're lucky and you get components that all work, right? But yeah, so if you click on the imager image, which I'll post that separately, I guess.
I see this.
It lists out all the components and where, like, how you can find them that you need. So I think the total is about $199. And you can get most of those things on eBay and things like that. And other sources. But yeah, you buy your own components and slap them all together and you got yourself a Nintendo Switch.
Worth noting, he's like, oh, this is to, you know, starve out online price gougers. Okay, at some point you post this, they're going to start gouging the prices on the bits too.
Right. Yeah.
Sorry, this buddy, but that's not how the economy works.
Well, it's kind of how it works. But you're right. Really you're cool, right. You're though. Absolutely right. It is really cool. It is really cool. I actually follow. So there's some people that one person in particular that I follow on YouTube. Let me see if I can find him real quick, because this guy is really cool. He doesn't do a lot with Switches. He mostly does stuff with like old Game Boys and such. But he literally just buys like broken Game Boys and Switches and Nintendo DSs and stuff, and he fixes them.
Yeah.
He's this skinny little British dude.
Yeah.
It's fascinating. It's really cool. Let me see if I can find him.
He did one. He bought like a burned out, full of dirt, original DS. Or no, yeah. Sorry, original
Game Boy Advance.
Game Boy Advance.
Yeah.
That one was sick. I was astonished at how beautiful that thing looked when he was done.
This guy's so cool. I absolutely love his channel. It really inspires me to want to try and do some of this stuff too, to be honest. God, why can't I find him? What is his name?
Adam's got a really good point. Once you build your Switch, how do you get the OS?
I'm guessing you probably buy.
I think when you buy the motherboard, it's got the.
It's pre-installed?
Yeah.
That was my thought. Yeah.
Like, that's
probably something that you just.
I would have to think, yeah.
Like, it's probably a used one. Like, someone's like, well, my right. Switch oh, okay. broke, you know, but that's here's fair. A motherboard that works, you know, the screen was broken, but here's everything else. So.
Right, and you can also, I've seen this guy actually repair broken Switch motherboards, too. God, why can't I find his stuff? Hold on. I'm sure if I just search this. Not excuse me, not Odd Tinkering. Retro Future, here he is.
Yep, Retro Future.
This is my boy. I'm going to post his YouTube link in here. This stuff's really cool. And if you want to like get some ideas on like maybe you want to replace the screen on one of your old Game Boys or, you know, cuz it's not looking as good as it used to or something like that. He's got videos on how to do that. It's really cool. He goes into detail too.
So one of the shoulder buttons is busted on my this one,
mm-hmm.
SP, and I'm pretty sure I can, with some amount of ease, follow his instructions and I have
get it
I
fixed
have a replacement.
Up, man. Yeah.
Yeah, like I have a replacement somewhere around here.
That's really cool.
Disaster, yeah. But I'm pretty like he's very clear about it. Like it's very one step at a time how to do it.
Yeah, it's great. It really has inspired me to want to try. I haven't done any of it yet, but I do have like my old Game Boy Advance that I bought in Japan. I want it to be beautiful again, you know? And I'm strongly considering buying some parts and fixing that bad boy up. Because it's to me it's worth it. It's super cool. So yeah, I've thought about maybe trying it first on like a different one, mm-hmm. just to like see if I get it right the first time, you know, and then if I'm successful, go ahead and do it on the you know, original one that I have. Because that's my first ever Game Boy Advance. I bought it in Japan. It, like, means the world to me. It's orange. It's a color that never came out here in the States.
Yeah, that's cool.
It's so cool. Yeah, I love it. Yeah, first game I had on it was Japanese Street Fighter.
Nice.
Yeah, because I was like, I was in Japan. I was like, what's a game that I could play without having to, like, understand what's going on? Even though I speak some Japanese, it's not enough to really play through a game. And I'm like, Street Fighter. I love Street Fighter games. And I can definitely, you know, play through that game without it being English. So,
yeah.
Yeah, it's awesome. But yeah, go check that guy out. Do you guys have any closing thoughts this week?
Stay safe, wash your hands.
Both of those things.
Stay safe, wash your hands, play video games.
Yeah. Dude, some of my friends the other day were talking about this. They're like, man, I've run out of games to play. I'm like, what? I played all my games I wanted to play and like did this and this and just like, man, that's crazy. So,
yeah, I'm not even close to running out of games.
That's my thought. I was like, oh, okay. Get on Steam, you know?
Yeah, right? There's so many free games that are good.
Yeah,
Josh, go are play. You live?
Yeah, are you live? Go live so we can raid you. Yeah, play Dead Cells. That's our featured game, and come talk about it in the podcast channel. Also, get clips, guys. We need clips for the Instagram. It's not completed yet, but we're gonna get it up, and that's what she said. And yeah, we absolutely need clips. Go ahead and send those to Lord Yeshua, or just post them in the clips channel, and I'll curate those and send them his way. But that would be really super helpful to us, guys. Would really, really appreciate that. Stay live, raid in 1 hour? We're not doing that. Is there someone else we can raid right now who's streaming?
I don't know.
Let's take a peek. Mandari's still live.
Yeah, Faye's live.
We can raid Mandari.
Right.
So... guys, I am Paul. You're on my Twitch channel right now. We also have the YouTube channel. I don't have the link currently, but you can check out our old videos, or if you missed the podcast, you can check that out there. Just search This Is Difficult Gaming Podcast in YouTube. Should be able to find that. I stream on Tuesday nights, Wednesday nights, and on Saturdays. I play games, so come check me out there. Zach, where can we find you, homie?
I'm Zach. I stream from the Another Letdown channel. I stream Thursdays, Fridays, and Saturdays. Thursdays, I do games that I'm really, really terrible at or have just missed for some reason. Fridays, I stream the board game Arkham Horror with a bunch of friends, and we have a rolling cast of guests. If either one of you is interested in learning a new board game, Paul, I know it's not your jam, let me know. And on Saturdays I do miniatures painting, and then very I'm good. Also on the Handelabra Games channel on Sundays.
Nice.
My YouTube is youtube.com/anotherletdowncf, and I've just posted Paul's YouTube in the chat because
oh perfect,
I happen to have it up.
It's our YouTube, guys. It's our YouTube.
Wait, I know you have a YouTube channel.
It's me? The This Is Difficult.
Not channel. You. Oh. I know we have.
Yeah, it's like I did sketch comedy for a while with a troupe called Another Letdown, or it was my troupe called Another Letdown, and then my partners went a different way with it and I started streaming instead, so it's just all my stream replays mostly.
Oh my gosh,
nice. That's crazy. Very nice. Colin, where can we find you, homie?
twitch.tv/4gs or 4gs on YouTube, I guess.
Yes.
Posting videos again. So.
I'm so excited about that. Is there any place that if people need work done for, you know, assets for videos or anything like that, things that you do that you want to plug?
Yeah, you can contact me.
Okay, just contact Colin. All right, cool.
He does right. Awesome animations like my he follow does animation that do triggered really... like twice yesterday, two or three times yesterday. I was so excited.
All of our animations that on my channel and on Lord Yeshua's channel are all done by Colin as well. So,
all right,
let's raid everyone have an awesome night. Thanks for joining. Be good. Be safe. Play video games.
Bye.
Have a great night. We're rating in 3, 2, 1. Boom. There we go.
I,